The views and comments expressed on the following radio program by its hosts and their guests do not necessarily reflect the views of RMCOnAir.com or its affiliates. Listener discretion is advised.
Hey, hey.
Good morning, good morning, good morning.
What's up? This is The Perspective. My name is Raylene Inez.
I am Fat Cam.
And welcome to The Perspective. How y'all doing today, world?
Hopefully y'all doing all right. Y'all alive?
We live. We are finally on air today. This is the first show of The Perspective. How you feeling, Fat Kim?
I am scared to death. This is my first time in front of any type of microphone of any type. I am no singer. I am no professional at any extent of this. I have no clue what I'm doing, but this is all free-handed, man. We just trying to, you know, bring some cool conversation to the table.
Cool.
So hopefully all my family and friends are listening. If you love me, you should be. Or we got a problem. I will be checking views and making calls, and I'll be quizzing some of you people on discussions of this just to make sure. And if you're really not there, then we really going to have some issues, for real.
All right. Well, we're going to do a little introduction of ourselves. My name is Raylene Inez.
My name is Cameron Prophet.
And we're just two youngsters about to give y'all perspective on views, social issues,
well,
stuff
like that. Let me stop you there. I'm kind of old. It's one youngster and one old man. I'm 28.
You're not that old.
I am old.
I'm 22. You're not that old. Whatever. Two youngsters, like I said, giving you guys views and perspectives that, you know, our generation pretty much don't touch bases on. So
even the ones that they do touch bases on, we'll be talking about a whole lot of things that we see on social media, things that we see in the news, things that we come across on a day-to-day basis, life, things that disgruntle us, work, sex, relationships, whatever it is that we want to talk about, we're going to talk about and discuss it freely, however we see fit. You know, we want to give a point of view from a young black male and female perspective on the climate of the world and the society today, you know? So.
So, let's first things first get into our question of the day. So, this is my question, and I was thinking about this all night, and my question is honestly and foremost, like, do people actually really believe in going and pursuing their dreams? Do people really believe that? Like, do people, like, really have that ambition to just go for what they believe? Like, because I feel like in this generation now, like, a lot of people don't. Like, I feel like a lot of people lack that ambition because I hear so many people saying, I want to do this, but they're not doing anything to go for it.
I think a lot of people do. That's why a lot of people are in debt right now, and that thing is called college. But there's another side of that where a lot of people are afraid of the debt that college comes with. And it's a lot of people where, or I won't say a lot of people, but there's a lot of scenarios where you go to school for certain things and you can't get a job in that field. So it deters people away from school because nobody wants to pay that student loan. So that kind of blocks
college
you.
Is expensive. Like, I'm going to just keep it G. Like, I ain't still pay my college back.
In my life, it's what college?
That's absolutely true, because when I was going to school, I mean, I could tell you this right now, like, I did not want to major in, like, some business. Like, I was like, I don't want to learn how to, I mean, I didn't want to, like, be pretty much like a restaurant owner. Like, I just knew that wasn't me. Like, I was like, what the fuck am I doing? And I took off school for about 2.5 years. I really got my life together, and look where I'm at. I'm sitting in this chair right now talking to my audience about going for your dreams, because this is my dream right here. And I tell everybody and anybody who wants to go for something, go for it. Put your time and your energy into what you're doing and go for it. I mean, of course you're going to fail. Of course you're going to stumble. Of course you're going to have doubt in your mind. But, I mean, you got to take all the negative energy out and just all you got to do is focus on positive. That's just my perspective.
See, like, my situation is I didn't really have that drive for a long time. I didn't have that drive. I really didn't have any type of real direction as to where I wanted to go. I did like CNA work for a little bit, and that kind of fizzled out. I had a client that passed away on me, and then once that happened, I was kind of like off it. And excuse me. I had gotten into podcasts maybe about a year and a half ago. And the more I listened to podcasts, it kind of excited me, and I always wished that I had the opportunity to do it, but I didn't have the resources. I didn't have a studio. I didn't have anybody who I really felt like I had something, have somebody who could bring something to the table where they could entertain me and have a decent conversation for an extended amount of time. So I was pretty much kind of like stuck in a rut, working BS jobs and things like that. So this is something where it was like when it came around, I had to kind of just grab it by the horns. You know what I'm saying? And I'm also hoping that this is one of those situations, like one of those success stories where they say, you know, oh, you know, he had to sacrifice this. You know, I'm turning away work so that I can make sure that my schedule here, it can be upkept so that, you know, we can snowball this thing into something like major. You know what I'm saying? And this can segue into some other ventures in life, and we can really do like a... Or at least me, I want to do on some like Dick Clark type shit, you know, Ryan Seacrest, for real. Because I mean, they start somewhere small,
yeah,
but then
they
you know they take their steps, and then it leads to other passages. You know what I'm saying? So we just want to ride this wave and see where it takes us. Hopefully, it takes us somewhere extremely far. I really want to take care of my son off of this.
I believe it do. I believe it do. Jesus, I ain't got no proper English. I think it can. I really think it. I believe in us. Shit, do you believe?
I don't know.
How you gonna say you don't know?
I'm just kidding. Of course, I wouldn't be here if I didn't. That would be
like,
a waste of my time.
What? Like, I
That'd
believe.
Be a waste of everybody's time.
I believe.
Room. Gas money, traffic time. We just had real traffic.
I know. Took y'all like 15 minutes to get here, but it's cool though. Like, it's cool. All right. So as long as you believe and I believe that we gonna make it far, that's all that matters, okay? Because yeah. I know that I'm gonna make it far. I feel good things from this, so I ain't even tripping. Right. You know, I just told my mom today, like, this is a start of new beginning.
Yeah, I haven't really talked to my mom. I saw her this morning. I said, hey, I'm on my way to the studio. She said, oh, that's good. She didn't seem very enthused about that shit.
Oh, my goodness, really? Really?
Really? I mean, she's like, yeah, that's good. I'm glad you're doing something. But, I mean, like, it wasn't like... Oh my God, can I sit in? Nah, it was like, all right, cool.
My mom was trying to sit in. She was like, oh, I need to meet the founder of this.
Mom's is like, I'm going to work.
What you trying to do? Why are you doing this? And I'm like, what? Like, she tries to, I swear to God, like, she was like, who all gonna be in the audience? I'm like, we're in the studio.
There's no audience, mom. It's just us.
Shout out to my moms. I love her to death. Okay, so, let's just take a short music break, and when we come back, we're going to hit you guys with something called Our Perspective. So keep it tuned real quick. I wasn't whipping this foreign.
Swear I came back top down. You're going to have to do more than just. You're going to have to do less for you. Some mommy, you know I always want you to. You're going to have to do more than just. You're going to have to do less for you. Some mommy, you know I. You gon' need to do more than just do it. I got though. Ever since you hopped in, shut my phone, slam my door. You know I know that you been on it, but I've been on it, on the low. So let a young nigga get down on it. Yeah, love when you spin round on it. Yeah, even though a young nigga want you. Shorty, I promise the truth, and when I come down on it, yeah, you love when I'm down on it. Yeah, fuck around, spend time on it. Yeah. So I came back top down. You gon' have to do more than just. You gon' have to do less for you. Some mommy, you know I always want you to. You gon' have to do more than just. You gon' have to do less for you. Some mommy, you know I. So you gon' need to do more than just. You know. know, baby. Freaking out the foreign, not to play, you know it's day six. Let a young nigga get down on it. Yeah, love when you spin round on it. Yeah, even though a young nigga want you. Shawty, I promise the truth, and when I come down on it, yeah, you'll love when I'm down on it. Yeah, fuck around, spend time on it. Yeah, so I came back top down. You gon' have to do more than just. You gon' have to do less when you. Tell mama you know I always want you to. You gon' have to do more than just. You gon' have to do less when you. Tell mama you know I. So you gon' need to do more than just. Do you?
Y'all, that was Tory Lanez, Say It. So,
everybody
now
loves
we're,
Tory Lanez.
No, not really. We're going to touch
Bryson
bases.
Bryson Tiller and Tory Lanez.
Okay, listen, check this out. We're gonna get to that. We're so going to get to that because that is actually this segment that we have right now. It's called Your Perspective. And actually, Tory Lanez is actually a part of the perspective of my part. So recently, VIA Shade Room, pretty much, I guess, it was Tory Lanez. He was on Twitter or whatever. This nigga was like, he the best R&B singer of all time, not including Chris Brown, right? And then, like, Jacquees was like, took it as a joke. And, like, Jacquees was on Insta. He had this cute-ass smile on his face talking about some, you got to do more than just say it, bro. And I just started dying laughing. And I like Tory. That's my favorite song by Tory Lanez right now is Say It, because I mean that's the only song he got. So
now he's got a few mixtapes,
but I mean they not on Jacquees or Bryson Tiller's level. Like, I'm gonna just keep that G, like, let's keep it real. Like, I ain't heard nothing else from Tory Lanez besides Say It that's on the radio.
I don't listen to none of them.
What?
I'm a hip hop head, number one. Okay, so R&B, I listen to R&B, but when I listen to old R&B. I don't listen to new stuff.
What's wrong with Bryson?
Nothing. It's just not for me.
Bryson cool though.
And I understand that. I'm just
Bryson finna take over the R&B world is like not even ridiculous. Bryson Tiller is selling out fucking shows right now. Like, this nigga's in Detroit, like, doing a damn thing.
Everybody listens to Bryson Tiller. When you go
half
on Snap,
niggas go to a Tory Lanez concert right now.
If you go on Snap, most of the
let
girls
go to a, all he gonna do is perform Say It though.
Nah, he's got more than that. You can't just have a show
he,
up. On
okay, he gonna perform Say It, and he's gonna perform I'm Guilty.
Nah, he's got a full set.
Whatever.
He's got a full set.
I heard that
dude's
shit.
He's got about four mixtapes.
Four mixtapes that hit what?
And they all like. I won't say all of them, but he's got a lot of songs where he's flipping like old R&B records.
He is. I give you that. He is. But it's like Bryson put out an album though. Like it was like Don't album. The album was hit though. The album was it.
That's
Jacquees, perfect album. Like, his album is actually decent.
I can't speak on neither one because I haven't heard their album.
Okay, well, you need to listen
I'm stuck in my realm.
That's just my perspective.
It's hard for me to get out of my box, though. I'm kind of...
Well, you need to make that box a little bigger.
I try.
Like, you need to, like...
It's a lot of...
We need to take you...
It's a lot of fuckery
Little Nemo,
out there.
And then put you in the ocean with all the sharks and shit. You know what I mean? Because I feel like there's so many people out here that's so talented, and I cannot wait to bring, you know, future guests and artists on this show.
Yeah. Definitely, I have to keep an open mind. I have to keep an open mind to new music. It's just like when it's mainstream, just for my own personal pleasures. I listen to about maybe five artists in rotation, and I'm the type of person that can hear a album. And if I like it, I can listen to that album every single day without feeling any type of way about it. I don't want to hear
that's
this album.
That's me with Bryson Tiller.
I will sit there and listen to a whole album
Bryson
that
Tiller
I've listened to several times.
For however long. That's just my shit. Like, I can play, I could play Bryson Tiller's album 7 days a week, 365 days a year, because his music just really touches me. I could fuck with Jacquees too. You know what I'm saying?
I haven't heard any Jacquees music.
He's like P-E-R-F-E-C-T-O, girl, you are. Oh, you don't know.
I think I heard that.
Yeah, that's him. And then, like, he has an album, and his album is pretty good.
I'll check it.
But, I mean, my top three, though, between Bryson and Jacquees and Tory, of course, it's Bryson Tiller. I'm sorry. Dude is just simply amazing. Like, he's just amazing. Like, he's talented. I just like what he, like, I just, I don't know. I just fuck with Bryson. Then it's like, Jacquees, of course, he's in the middle because it's like, he ain't been on tour yet. I mean, he just put out his first album still. He making a couple of hits. And then it's Tory Lanez. Like, he just really just got one hit record. And he's just going to have to prove to the rest of the world and myself that he's more than just say it. That's just my perspective on that.
To all my older listeners, if you want to fuck with some real R&B, pick up an Eric Benet album or some Mint Condition.
Boy,
Teddy Pendergrass.
I like some Mint Condition and some. I don't get it twisted. I love me some old R&B, but I'm just talking
always
about hot right now.
Always make some moist.
I hate you. I really hate you. What's your perspective on today, Kim? That was my perspective of the week.
That was your perspective of the week?
So what's your perspective of the week? What did you see on, you know, social media that was just like...
All right, well, let's talk about the most recent thing that's happening.
What?
The Academy Awards.
were you able to watch them?
Okay, check this out. I did not watch them, but you know, Shade Room always keeps me informed on what the hell's going on in the world. And Baller Alert and all these other good blogs and stuff like that. And we have a clip of the Oscars. Some of the things that Chris Rock was saying, some of the things that that he touched bases on. And it's just like the last clip. Oh, yeah, we're going to talk about that. So here's the clip right now, y'all. Check it out.
Boycotting the Oscars is like me boycotting Rihanna's panty. I wasn't invited.
You know, it's not about boycotting anything. It's just we want opportunity. We want the black actors to get the same opportunities.
And let me tell you some good news. The Academy has taken steps to fix this problem. And that is why it is my honor to introduce the new director of our minority outreach program. Please welcome Miss Stacey Dash.
I cannot wait to help my people out. Happy Black History Month.
All right. So, I didn't see the Oscars, but I saw multiple clips of the Oscars. I really didn't care for the Oscars, to be honest, because it was just like, ugh. I was actually on a date when that happened. I was on a date with a dude. But my perspective on the Oscars, I totally, some of the things that Chris Rock was saying about how African Americans want more opportunity in this world, of course, I do believe that. And he actually said something like, you know, like we didn't, like in the 60s and the, you know, in the 50s and the 60s, like we didn't care. We pretty much, what he was saying in the most professional way that he said it was, we didn't give a fuck about the Oscars in the 60s because we had real shit issues to talk about. We had real issues. Like we was going through segregation. You know, it was whites and blacks only. Like we were getting lynched.
He also made another point that was very, very, like, that was correct. That was the 88th annual Academy Awards. Every year, I'm pretty sure, especially in the beginning, there were probably a lot of years where there were no black nominees.
No, exactly.
It's probably just been a while since it's been like that. And they did snub Will. He should have at least got a nomination for Concussion. I did see it. I did enjoy it. But
he did a good job.
In today's society, everything is overly sensitive. We like you can't really do anything without someone having something negative to say. Somebody's gonna nitpick at whatever it is that you're doing. Of course, there is a racist system in Hollywood. But what we need to stop doing is relying on white validation. And while everybody is talking about the Oscars, nobody is speaking about what Russell Simmons is doing. He had his own movie award show, and where he had several black people come up. No, I haven't really seen anything or anyone speaking about that. Everybody's talking about how white the Oscars is instead of saying, look, let's take a look at the black-owned shit that we got over here.
True.
Let's support this shit. Let's push this to the forefront, and let's get we can segregation in some situations is okay, because if you're looking for somebody to hand you some shit, you don't need to do that. We got our own. Just like how there are other cultures in the United States that work for themselves, we need to start doing that same shit and get ourselves up. Let's uplift ourselves before we start looking for white people to validate us in certain situations. We know we make good movies, so let's help hold our own shit. You know what I'm saying? So we can celebrate ourselves the way we want to be celebrated.
That's true.
So being mad at an all-white Oscars, you know, however they do their selection.
This is my thing on the Oscars. It was for you know how we got BET Awards, of course. That's that, you know, but here's my thing, BET was never segregated though. Let's keep that G. Sam Smith just won Best New Artist 2015, if I'm not mistaken. He won an award with BET though. Let's just keep that true. He won something there.
You've seen Justin Timberlake on the BET stage?
Yeah, we've seen multiple people of color. Not multiple people of color, different races on the BET stage.
Homeboy from CNN come through every year at the BET Awards.
So it's kind of it's not a racist thing. I don't understand that. BET's not racist. Some of these award shows is it's okay to have the country music awards. You ain't go see unless you black doing country music. If you just a hip-hop artist, I'm not going to see no hip-hop artist at no damn country music. We just not going to see that. Country's for country, Latino Music Awards, that's for them. BET Awards, that's for us as African-Americans. What else? What's a good show that's for everybody? The Grammys. The Grammys is a award show for everyone to come together. That's how I feel about the Oscars. The Oscars should be like that, straight up. The Oscars is an award show for everyone to come together. You know what I'm saying? That's just my side.
I feel like as an Academy, they should have looked at that list of nominees, and especially in today's climate, they should have known. Somebody should have had enough wherewithal to say, you know what? Some people may have an issue with this list that's about to go out. You think that these black people that like to have an uproar about every small little tidbit, you think that they're gonna let this list fly with no color? They should have had somebody up there. But
if they was able to have 3-6 Mafia win a damn Oscar, bro, I feel like number one, Will Smith should have got his goddamn Oscar for Concussion, and Leonardo DiCaprio, hallelujah, finally.
My man.
That fucking Oscar was so overdue. When I found out he won, I was like, hey, I was at K1 Speed, Because, I really do feel Leonardo should have got that fucking Oscar.
He should have got it for Wolf of Wall Street.
He should have got it for that.
Great Gatsby. I like that movie.
Great Gatsby. Titanic. He should have got it for so many movies that he played in and actually did a damn good job. Yeah. I salute Leonardo. Congratulations on your fucking Oscar, go get drunk.
Just in case you guys don't know by now, Leonardo is black. I am part of the black delegation that was seen on the Dave Chappelle show, and we have recruited him many years ago. Just in case you guys do not know,
we just recruited Gary Owens after Stacey Dash did that dumbass.
Oh yeah, we've been had Gary. Gary was always black.
Gary kids is black. Gary wife is black. So, that's that's automatic.
That's automatic.
Nigga's black.
That's like when you marry a Muslim. You automatically.
That part.
But let's touch on Stacey Dash. That joke she did, it was a joke.
It was a horrible joke.
It was very distasteful.
It was horrible. That left a really bad taste in my mouth. Bitch, how the hell is you gonna sit here? I touched on this on Snap a while ago too. I'm gonna just keep that G. I touched on this on Snap a month ago when this bitch was on air talking about some, I don't think we should have Black History Month at BET Awards. Bitch, what? Run BET they money back for you being on fucking Clueless.
Yeah, she must have forgotten all of that. They were extremely petty when they did all of that.
Yo, that Instagram your shit. First cousin Dame Dash is your first cousin, bitch, you're black.
Yeah, she was in all the Rockefeller. Yeah, she's on a Republican. She's a Republican correspondent for Fox News, and they pretty much are using her as a puppet, where she's just going out there
and just saying a whole bunch of shit
that doesn't make any sense. And,
then she just got a big ass check for playing that stupid joke on the Oscars. Like, I said Oscars. Like, yo,
I don't know if you get paid for being up there.
They probably do. Who knows? But all I gotta say is this: like, she's just dumb.
That joke. Number one, it's too soon. Number two, it was kind of that. I don't know.
I feel like Chris Rock set her up. Like, Chris Rock was like, all right, you wanna. I feel like Chris Rock was pretty much like, oh, okay. I feel like Chris Rock was like, okay, since you want to sit here and talk all this mess, I got you. We're going to put you on blast. I want to make you feel stupid. I feel like that's what he did.
That's why Chris was hired, because Chris has always been that when you watch Chris's stand-up, he'll touch on race. He don't have no problem.
He did that today. So, he did that on the Oscars.
So that was a part of Chris being Chris. That's exactly what he was hired for. But that joke in particular, it didn't go over well. It wasn't received well. Black people already feel a way. And if that was her attempt to get back in the good graces of black people to try and
roll it off,
it didn't do anything but make
it
didn't do anything but make the whole situation worse. And she just really needs to just remain where she is. Stay over there. Get your money with Fox. And just not talk. Let's keep it distant.
Just don't speak up on the African-American race at all. Lady.
Because you've already been traded, boo.
By Gary Owens.
Keep it
over
there.
Sorry, but it's the real deal, because she just get on my nerves. Like, how dare you say that? Like, our people went through so much. First of all, this is another thing that pissed me off about the Oscars. Let me just touch on this. I don't know. It was a segment on the Oscars that I saw on the Shade Room. Again, shout out to Shade Room. Where it was like, the Oscars was doing, like, you know, like a little segment, and it was like Black History Month Minute. I was like, okay, I'm over the Oscars right then and there.
Who did that?
Yeah, the Oscars. They had like this little segment, like they had the little TV screen. It was like Black History Month Minute, and they were like putting like, you know, like segments of Black History Month. And I was just like, damn, like, I mean, it's already bad enough that freaking Black History Month is in February. It's already bad enough that February has a leap year. So we don't know if we have 28 days, 29 days. And then we got it in the shortest month of the whole year. So it's like Black History Month Minute. Like, we need more than a minute. Like, we've overcame. Like, we shall overcome. Like, we overcame a lot from compared to the 60s to now. But we still dealing with the racism and stuff still to this day. In all aspects of life, with jobs, entertainment industry, any industry that you go into and want to go through with, there's always some type of racism there, period, point blank. Racism still do exist. And I mean, I'll just hope as a people that we could really find some type of way to really just bring that barrier down.
Speaking of racism, though, did you hear about the riot that happened out in Anaheim?
Oh, you talking about with the KKK?
Yeah.
Yes, I did hear about that.
I got some inside information on that, because one of the guys that was in that whole...
you said it was your friend, right?
Yeah, it was a guy that I went to school with. And okay. I had just came in contact with one of his best friends. Actually, the dude I spoke to was actually supposed to be out there.
Really?
He was going to be arrested. So, to my knowledge, from what I was told, there was a KKK rally... for immigration. I guess they were protesting against the immigration out in Anaheim. They were met with anti-KKK protests.
Okay.
That protest ended up getting out of hand. And then in the end, 13 people ended up getting arrested. 3 people ended up getting stabbed. There was a guy out there with an American flag on a flagpole. And what
I think he
was
got
doing,
stabbed with it, right?
The KKK guy.
Yeah.
He stabbed one dude who was in critical condition, and he poked a couple other people up, like 2 other people up, and there was blood all over the street.
I see now.
Things like this are, I feel like it's only going to get worse.
It is, absolutely. Absolutely,
we're reaching a boiling point.
Because our generation is not the 60s. We're not going to freaking be like Martin Luther King. No disrespect to the man of Martin Luther King who fought for us. Rest in peace, Martin Luther King. You were a legend. don't get it twisted. We gonna be on more of the Malcolm X side, more of the hood side. Like, hey, look, we gonna fight back, motherfuckers. We not gonna sit here and be like, we shall over. Nah, fuck all that. Y'all motherfuckers has been abusing us, lynching us, putting us through slavery, segregating us. All we wanna do is be fucking equal to y'all motherfuckers. So if that means blood is gonna be shed, so fucking be it.
I feel
period, point blank. That's just how I feel because we are at a boiling point as a race and as a unit. Like, we just tired of these, we just tired of just being, I just feel like we just tired of being picked on.
I feel like.
We just tired.
Everybody has a right to protest.
Everybody does.
That's what America is about. Everybody should have a right to protest except for people who belong to a hate group. That is domestic terrorism.
The KKK? Yes, that's a terrorist group.
Domestic terrorism. Your group is known for bombing churches, killing black people, lynching.
So why is that even going on? Like, this is stuff to see the government. I don't even want to get into all that.
It's, you really shouldn't. Honestly, it was dope because if you look on Facebook, somewhere on Facebook, there's a gallery where there's a lot of dope pictures, like some real strong pictures of that whole thing. They're all in black and white. But almost lost my train of thought, but it was dope to see the protesters against the KKK. It wasn't just black. I saw Mexican, I saw whites, I saw blacks, and they were all out there fighting. They had signs. They came. This was a scheduled protest, so it wasn't like they saw KKK members just walking down the street. This was something that they heard about and said, okay, they're going to be here on Saturday at this time. Okay, we're going to be there with our signs too. Mm-hmm. And then it ended up getting ugly. It shouldn't have gotten ugly. I wish our people could really just let the foolishness just be the foolishness. Stay above the foolishness. But in certain cases, sometimes you just got to punch a motherfucker in the mouth.
Sometimes we just got to be petty to get the point across, because it's like we're just tired of trying to be peaceful with y'all motherfuckers. And y'all motherfuckers are still want to do shit that happened, 50 some plus years ago. Like, yo, like we have, look, check this out. In the Constitution, we have that right to, number one, freedom of speech, freedom to bear arms. We have a right to protest peacefully. Like, I don't understand how the KKK is allowed to protest. Like, I just don't. I mean, I understand they have the right to freedom of speech, but it's like, let's pick up a history book, guys. Let's please do that. Like, we all know that the KKK has lynched people, bombed churches, all of that. Like, I just don't understand how this group is still. I feel like all of them should be arrested. Like, KKK guys, they just put them up somewhere.
Yeah.
Like, they if they can't like get over the fact that we're gonna be here, we're gonna stay here, and that part of history has died, and they need to like let that go. They just need to be in jail, because it's like all they're gonna do is continue to pass that down from generation to generation to generation to generation, and it's like they're gonna teach their kids and their kids like don't like black people, don't like minorities. For what? We cool as fuck. Like, don't fuck with us, we won't fuck with you. Hey, how you doing? Let's keep it pushing. I don't understand why.
What's funny about that though is that the black man is the most replicated being on the planet.
Absolutely.
I have been in situations where I've been hated by somebody who is wearing the same shoes as me. You have practically the same haircut that I have. You're wearing the same clothes that I have, but yet you hate me. You have Jordans on your feet. Like, how can you possibly hate me when the man that's supporting your arch right now is a black man?
Mm-hmm.
I've been called a nigger. And by Hispanics, I have more issues with Hispanics than I have with white people, because in my area, there's more Hispanic people than there are white people, of course. So I don't really come across black and white racist. When I do, it's more so just out in the public. I see it and I don't pay it any mind. But in situations like where, you know, you might be a young dude walking down the street. I've been jumped walking home from work, 12 o'clock at night. Leaving the train station, I was 18 at the time, might have been 17, 18 at the time, walking home. Where you from? I don't gangbang. Got jumped. Four niggas. Four Mexicans, I would say.
So stupid.
And in this, though, they look like me. You know what I'm saying? And
you look like you could be mixed with Mexican, too.
Nah. please don't play my blackness. I love it. But but it's just weird because it's like we are these other cultures and these other races take things from us, yet you still hate us. Don't replicate us and then try and
I actually seen a little Asian girl rocking some braids. I see I got my braids right. So I seen a little Asian girl. She was on Instagram. I think she got like real Instagram famous, Twitter famous, whatever. Because she was rocking box braids and they was like, oh, why are you trying to be black? And she went off. She was like, my nigga, like y'all fucking get Chinese bangs.
I did see that.
And y'all get y'all inches and all that shit. Like y'all look like the white people. Like why can't I look like how I want to look? I feel like she was just embracing our culture, and now, I didn't feel no type of way of it. I was like, girl, you look cute anyway. Don't let these haters flip.
Now, from a different perspective, though, how do you feel about, because what I've been seeing on the blogs as well, and I kind of feel ashamed that I know this because I'm a man, but.
And if I don't know it, it's going to be like 10 times worse.
I've seen.
What is it?
Like what they're doing with Kim Kardashian and Khloe Kardashian. I hate that we're talking about them on the show, but they have pictures of them.
Didn't we say we wasn't going to talk
about
them?
Yeah. But
how did they end up in our conversation?
This is more so about the hairstyle. But they've been wearing the cornrows and all of that, and they call them, instead of being box braids, they call them boxer braids. That's what they say on like the white
They
blogs.
Actually got like a lace.
And so now what they're doing is saying like this is like the new trend, and like because you see Kylie, you see Kim, you see Khloe, you see all of these other non-black celebrities wearing these braids that black people have been known to wear for so long, and now it's just kind of like y'all took it and just the wave blew up. It's kind of like cultural appropriation.
This is my thing when it comes to the K clan of the Kardashians and shit.
The other KKKs.
I hate you. I really do for that. I hate you. All right, we not even gonna get. Oh, I hate you. I'm gonna punch you after the show. All right, check this out. This is what I'm thinking right now. It's been fucking celebrities before the K, the Kardashians. I'm gonna call them the K's because I don't feel like saying all their damn names, but. The Kardashians or whatever. It was honestly like artists before them, celebrities before them rocking the damn cornrows and shit. Like, what's her fucking face? Chanel West Coast, for example. She be having French braids in her hair all the time with her little black self. The little girl went to Taft High School. You know what I'm saying? She black. She could rap, whatever. Who else? It's so many celebrities out here that's taking like embracing our culture. Yeah. I have no problem with that, though.
I don't either. My only issue is I don't have any issue with any other race wearing braids, dreads, any of that. If that's your style, rock your style, do what you do. But what it is what I'm seeing is that black people have been known to rock braids. That's just the black style.
Of course.
Now, I'm not saying that it's impossible or wrong for another culture to wear braids, but we've kind of curated that look. Now, when you take that look, because a few A-list celebrities have done that, and then you try to make it seem like this is just the new trend, like this is something that they have started, then that's where I take issue with it, because it's like, dog, I saw Sanaa Lathan with some braids in Love and Basketball, if I'm not mistaken. Didn't she have some cornrows or something like that?
Yes, she did.
I didn't see her on probably wasn't no blog sites back then, but I ain't see nobody say, oh, look at those boxer braids. Look how she's wearing those cornrows. You know, it's kind of awkward. It's a lot of motherfuckers around here looking like Allen Iverson. Ain't nobody said nothing about him. But let Kim do it. Then she's a fucking star for it. I don't get that shit. Let's stop celebrating bullshit, man. It's just a whole bunch of fuckery out here. I don't understand.
Trust me, them, all them bitches, they've been rocking cornrows since the beginning of time. That ain't nothing new to me. Like, I've seen so many celebrities who's non-African American who's rocked French braids before.
I was about to say something about what my mom does with her hair, but I'm not going to do that. I'll say it anyway. My mom wraps her hair up in cornrows before she goes to bed. My mom wears her hair naturally. Shout out to all the natural hair sisters out there. No perm juice in there.
I got a perm in my head.
Just saying. That's you know what? The natural wave is really starting to become a wave. I'm seeing a lot of people like cut their hair like completely the fuck off to start over. Like that's the new
Perms actually do damage your hair. Yeah. I mean, personally, okay, check this out. Like I originally rock short hair, if y'all don't know, but you know I got the braids in today. I just feel like cause my hair too damn nappy. I'm not about to be dealing with that shit. So yeah, I put a perm in my head until it's time for me to I'm gonna cut all my hair off and regrow it, because the perm is not good for your hair. It really isn't. The dyes and shit that I do to my hair, it ain't good. I'm just doing it right now because my hair is short, and if it do fall out, niggas ain't gonna notice. So so it's like, and I could just put braids in my head when, you know what I'm saying, when it's about that time. Mm. So I mean, at the end of the day, I mean, I don't have no problem with African Americans rocking perms and, you know, all these protective hairstyles. I feel like us as a unit, we look good with any damn thing, a weave, a braid, short hair, a nice afro, a texturizer, all that good stuff. Because I feel like we the only race that can do all those styles.
Now, while we're discussing race, though, I don't want this podcast to come across as if we're like racist or anything like that. I love all facets of people.
We're not racist. We're just strongly like, just we pro-black. Just love our people. We love just love people, being African American, and we're just going to stand up for it, because at the end of the day, guess what? This is our perspective. So
if you don't like it,
who cares?
Turn it off. How about
well,
that?
Well, no, we need viewers first.
Yeah, I mean, but I don't want no haters on here.
Yeah, we don't want no haters. I don't want y'all to think that, like, we hating on other races, because we not. It's just that we just love being who we are as African Americans, and I just want African Americans to cherish that part of us. So, Cameron, guess what? We have an email. We got an email today. All right. So I'm gonna read it to you. Let's pray I can read this morning, because I ain't ate. So okay, so it says, "Hey, The Perspective, I am a young girl who's suffering from a heartbreak of 3 years. He is a guy that I also lost my virginity to. Recently, I have been trying to get over him by, of course, talking to other dudes and going on dates, but that's just not working for me. He recently hit me up to talk. I don't know what to do. Should I give him the time of day or kick his ass to the curb because he truly broke my heart? Sincerely, the Georgia Peach." First things first, shout out to the ATL, whoever sent this email in. I appreciate you. So, what's your perspective, Cam?
I would like to have known what it was that he did to break her heart.
I'ma assume it's cheating. Because, I mean, that's the only thing that a girl would break up with you for.
But not necessarily. Not necessarily. There's a lot of things that you've broken up for. But cheating is a main thing. So let's just go with that. We'll just go with the cheating thing, because that's the easiest thing to go with. That's a trust thing. I've dealt with that, going back and forth with somebody time and time again. Sometimes you expect different results and you don't get it. Sometimes it happens the same. Sometimes shit goes good for a while, then it goes back into the same patterns. So I can speak from that, from experience, but if that's pretty much just a play-by-play, like that's your, it depends on your situation. I can't really, I don't know what this dude did to honestly answer if you should take him back or kick him to the curb for whatever reason. But let's say if he did cheat, if y'all feel like y'all can get past that and that's where you truly want to be, and y'all can come to some agreements, and you can fully trust this person, and y'all feel like y'all won't have that issue anymore, then by all means, give it another shot. Maybe it might end up happening something, you know. I don't know the extent of your relationship, how many times you've dealt with this. All of that comes into play. But when you're fed up with shit, you'll know it. You know what I'm saying? So if you really want to be happy, I say what you should do is just continue to date. The only reason why you haven't gotten over this person is because you haven't found the right person to get over this person with. So, or maybe you don't need someone to get over with this person. You might just need to be by yourself and let that shit get out your system, just like a normal breakup. Everybody goes through that when they break up with somebody that they love. They get sick, they don't want to eat, they don't want to go nowhere, they don't want to talk to nobody. So trying to date somebody after a rebound, it can be difficult because your mind is on something else or on someone else. So, and then you end up comparing your new person to the old person in a lot of ways. And that doesn't work out. Nobody wants to be compared to the ex. So I would say if y'all can come to some kind of agreement where y'all feel like, okay, we can try this again and, you know, knock this out the park this time, let's walk straight, then by all means, give it a shot. Because, I mean, people make mistakes. I have cheated on someone before, and I'd never do
this
it again.
Nigga right here.
I'd never do it again. You know what I'm saying? Like, I mean, people grow and people learn. That's you learn from your mistakes, and that's part of life. You fuck up, you can redeem yourself in some situations. In some situations, but
I feel it.
Depending on how bad you fucked up, and if you feel like it's something that's not worth it, then by all means, get rid of it.
All right.
You know what I'm saying?
Check this out. This is my perspective on your letter, Sweet Pea. Miss Georgia Peach, check this out. I know what it's like to be hurt by someone that you've, you know, of course, you shared that, you know, you shared your body with. I understand that hurt and that pain. Personally, me, it took me about a cool, I'll put my dirty laundry out there. It took me a year to get over the person that I lost my virginity to. I'm going to keep that true. I'm going to keep that real. I was suffering through a lot of shit when I was going through him. And personally, to keep it G, I wouldn't go back to that road. Just keep your mind forward. Because if y'all didn't work the first time, what the hell makes you think it's going to work a second? That's just me, boo-boo. Continue to date. I understand that you love him. You've been with him for 3 years. All that good stuff, but certain things just don't work out. And you just have to face that reality. I'm being a little bit more harsh about it because I am a woman and I understand. Look, girl, it's too many men out there to even sit here contemplating on a man that you love. I understand that you love him. Don't get me wrong, because that's a person that you loved and you cherished. And that's someone that you thought you saw yourself. That's someone that you thought that you seen yourself with for the rest of your life. But unfortunately, I'm sorry that 3 year road had came to an end. And I mean, yeah, he did recently hit you up to talk. You can talk to him and see where he trying to go with it. But if he ain't talking about changing his ways, if he ain't talking about trying to be a better man for you, girl, continue to date. Don't even give that nigga the time or the day, because women are beautiful on the inside and out. And don't let these niggas out here mistreat us as women, because we fall into that mindset. So it was like, just put on your big girl panties and hit the high road, girl. Just, if he wants to talk, by all means, give him, you could hear him out, see what he coming to the table with. But if he ain't coming with nothing right, girl, you better put on your big girl panties and keep it pushing, because it's so many men out here that you could possibly find out there, especially in the ATL. So go ahead, girl. You in a big city.
I wouldn't say about in the ATL. I just read something very shocking where it was like 80% of the men out in Atlanta are
On the down low
or homosexual.
Okay, well.
So the pickings are slim in Atlanta.
Okay.
But what I would say to that, though, is that
let's not bash her nigga, because
I'm not talking about gay or nothing like that, but I'm just talking about if you feel like you should leave this person alone, I would say hold off
on dating. If it's too much negative energy in that, like, let's not forget about that. If y'all broke up on mutual terms and okay, then you go back. But it's like if the relationship was too toxic, don't go back for what? It's just gonna bring your energy down. You don't have no time for that, boo. Go for your dreams, like I said earlier.
If you gotta leave the situation alone, then I would advise you to not go out and go date somebody, because that's not going to necessarily work.
Work on your spiritual healing first.
Work on yourself. Get your shit together. Clear your mind. And before
Enjoy
you start...
Enjoy being single before you get back in a relationship, because I'm in a relationship. I love my relationship, though.
But make sure that you are completely over the old shit before
yes,
you decide
of course,
to have somebody around, because you might end up making that new person uncomfortable
because you're still not over your ex.
And sometimes I know what the saying is. They say the best way to get over an ex is to get under a new one. So sometimes that shit don't work.
That's a whole other story. We gonna talk about on a perspective, because I did
all of that shit and it didn't work. And honestly, I'll give you something honest. I did all of that because it took my mind off of what she was doing.
Exactly.
I did
it
that
does.
So it would take my mind off what she was
it
doing.
It makes you feel so much like shit after. Like, I know I felt like shit after. Like, I swear to God, like, I was trying my hardest to get over my first love. And then it's like, after I done doing what I did, the motherfucker called me.
See, I treated, see, but this is what I did. Because I'm real good at retrospect. I like to look back at things that I've done. I noticed that there was a pattern in what I was doing. I treated a lot of the girls that I was dealing with during that time like shit, because I didn't truly care for them, because I was really just there to get some shit done, to take my mind off of whatever the fuck she was out doing. She was thotting around, whatever the fuck it was. And I was hurt. You know what I'm saying? So I didn't particularly care for the women that I was dealing with. It was just more so just like something to occupy my time. And then when I was done, or if I had whatever, it was the smallest thing. I didn't care. I would just leave. Like my I don't know. And I know it's an I am an asshole, a self-professed asshole. I know that. I'm an asshole to the core. So I know you're not gonna make me feel bad about whatever the fuck it is that I did. I know I did that shit. That shit was kind of grimy. But in my mind state, it was just what I was going through. And whatever it was that would set me off about that person, I would just stop talking to them with no notice. Sometimes they didn't even have to do anything. It was just that I would wake up someday and I would just not want to pick my phone up and I didn't want to talk to this person anymore. Mm. I don't do that anymore, of course, because I'm past that. But when I was going through that time of just being hurt, hurt people. So that's what I was doing.
You an asshole.
I am an asshole. And sometimes my asshole is very beneficial. But sometimes it does fuck people up.
A couple times. I've been an asshole.
I'm an asshole every day of my life. But I love it.
We just gonna tell you this. Go with your heart. But I would definitely say keep what we said in the back of your mind. I hope that what we told you helped your question a little bit more. So to end off the show. All right, I'm going to give you I'm going to give y'all a little bit of something. So at the end of the show, we're going to pretty much, this is what it is, y'all. I'm big on quotes. So I feel like quotes can really help you go throughout your day, throughout your week, you know. And there's a lot of quotes out here from a lot of amazing people. And there was a time in my life where I was going through something and I just started writing quotes down on my big ass mirror that I have in my house. And I started picking up like being Mary Jane one by one. I took that idea, by the way. So it really helped me. It was something that always I kept in the back of my mind. And here's the first quote of the show. The first quote says, "Living in dreams of yesterday, we find ourselves still dreaming of impossible future conquest." And because I was talking about going for your dreams and going for your goals, I feel like this is a quote that you pretty much... Okay, first of all, the quote is by Charles Lindbergh. I have no idea who he is, so next week we're going to find out who he is because I just picked that quote. You know who he is?
Yep.
Oh, hey, Des.
Hey.
Just letting you know, you live right now.
Oh, hi. Good morning.
So who is Charles Lindbergh, since Miss Educator?
Well, you know, I went to Lindbergh Middle School. Shout out to Lindbergh. And he was a pilot, you know, he flew over. He went missing. It's rumored that our school is like in the shape of an airplane. I don't really know, but that's the whole.
We might have to Google that.
You know, background.
Okay, so just so happens that you actually went to his middle school, which is actually dope. But yeah, the quote of our show, the quote of the week for us will be, "Living in dreams of yesterday, we find ourselves still dreaming of impossible future conquests." Keep that in the back of your mind. Keep that in your energy, people. Please keep that with you. Because I feel like, tomorrow's a new day. And it's, honestly, tomorrow's a new day. And that's honestly a start of something even bigger of yesterday. So pretty much, y'all, just go for your dreams. Once again, I am Raylene Inez.
Oh, before we go, I want to talk about some music real quick. another purpose of this show is also...
I'm gonna kick you.
Another purpose of the show is also to get people to come on and explore some new music. So what we want to do is have people come onto the show.
Right.
And our listeners, if you have anybody that's on the come up, if you have anybody that's on the come up, anybody that you feel like has some dope music, whether they're a singer.
That's talented.
Super talented. We don't want any fuckery because I don't know about you. I will let you know.
If
you
come up here
with some bullshit, I will throw your shit the fuck out of here.
Stop. You make them not want to come on this show. Yeah,
so no, that should just make sure that you but make sure that your out. Shit is on point when you come up
if
here.
If you got some music, if you think you talented, if you are a singer, a rapper, an artist, a comedian, a model, whoever you are, if you're up and coming and want your stuff on air, online, on stream with our show, please email me at RayleneInez2Zs@gmail.com. Also, if you do have a letter that you guys want to be read on air and answered live, please send you guys' letters and questions to ask4theperspective@gmail.com.
Also, follow Ask for the Perspective on IG.
Please do. We need followers, y'all. So
subscribe
follow us on IG. Follow us on IG, which is Ask4ThePerspective. Also, follow our personal Instagrams and our lives and all that good stuff. You can follow me at Raylene Inez with two Z's.
You can follow me at FatCam, FatTCam. And you can add me on Snapchat, FatTCam, three T's.
So you got three T's in your Snapchat?
Three T's on the Snapchat, two T's on the Instagram.
I'll give y'all my Snapchat next week. I don't want to give it to y'all right now.
I'll give it to y'all. I need some snaps.
I'm going to give y'all my snap next week, but I might as well give it to y'all now. My Snapchat is Rayda Rose, RayDaRoz, three A's and a Y. So please make sure y'all follow me. I was being mean to y'all. I'm sorry. Y'all can follow me. I'm really nice on Snapchat. So please, y'all. I appreciate everyone who tuned in today. This was our first episode of The Perspective with more to come.
Absolutely. I'll be back weekly.
We'll be back here Wednesday from 9 a.m. to 10 a.m. This is The Perspective, and we're outro.
Y'all take care, man. We'll see y'all next week.